God, laying your majesty aside. You reached down in love to show me life, lifted from darkness into light. Oh, King for a slave, trading your righteousness for shame. Despite all my pride and foolish ways, caught in your infinite embrace. Oh, and I find myself here on my knees again, caught up in grace like an avalanche. Nothing compares to this love, love, love burning in my heart.
Initially came really as supporting my wife as she began to have much more demand for her services and for the retreat ministry. I'm a licensed social worker, and on every weekend healing program, there's a counselor. So I would serve on some retreats as a counselor. And that was the best education in the world you could get to understand. And I really had no understanding of the depth and how widespread the impact of abortion is until I started attending these retreats. Because there was women, men, couples, grandparents, even siblings sometimes who had experienced abortion loss of a sibling or half-sibling. So that was a real education, and then I particularly became focused on and interested in what I was seeing in terms of men's experience of abortion loss. You know, they came initially often to support their wives or their partners who may have had a previous abortion or they had an abortion together. And so I started seeing that profound impact in men's lives, and that really struck an interest in that I felt I needed to share that with the public and call other men to healing.
And the real biggest lie today is the word choice. Free will is what God gave us. Free will is what we're supposed to use, free will to do His work and to follow His will. He gave us that choice, and you know, and when we use that word choice, or when the culture uses the word choice as a means to kill, this is the biggest lie. There's no choice. The baby has no choice in the matter whatsoever, and the devil really is, it's really a satanic thing. People don't look in that level of things a lot of times, but when you look at it, how can you have a culture that denies the 3,000 to 4,000 babies that are killed every single day in this culture, in this country? How can you have something like that and not open it up, you know, and question it? It's because the media has pushed it down and called it choice, and it says whatever it is, it's her right to do it. We can't live in a situation like that where killing is the result of her right to do it. And by the way, that's a subterfuge, because it's his right to tell her what to do, or he'll leave her. That's also wrapped up in this, because abortion really destroys not just the mother's confidence, but also the boyfriend, whatever, breaks up, and people who are married have problems with their siblings, understand this. So the whole area of abortion is extremely important. It is not just a matter of, you know, coming in and having a little procedure and going on and washing your hands with all that and going on with life. It doesn't work that way. We know that because we know the after effect. I sometimes in my homilies talk about the pound of cure versus the ounce of prevention. Do we know what we're going to do beforehand so we do the right thing? It will prevent a disaster afterwards. And so the pound of cure is going in the mercy of God. Yes, people have made mistakes. Yes, they've sinned. That doesn't end it. We want to help them come back. They can't deny it. They may try to deny it, but they suffer from this. So we want to bring them back in healing. That's what Rachel's Vineyard Retreat's about. It's a huge area. And to see that, you know, we just don't keep people stewing in their own problems, but bringing them in later on. So there's the before and the after in this abortion issue. It's about human justice, you know, and as one of our colleagues says very well, he says that social justice begins in the womb. And when we see the numbers and the effects that it has on us, that's why it's so important to talk about abortion and why we need to blow open the idea of the word choice. There's a choice, and the choice is to do the right thing. Yeah, we all have a choice, and it's to do that right thing, which we know is life. Here. The one is it life? Is what we're talking about in the womb a living human being or not? And may I kill it? That's the second question. I mean, they don't frame it that way in killing. They don't want to look at it that way. But see, that is a denial, which again goes back to what I was saying on a supernatural level. There's a diabolical thing that's in there that posits that denial. But you have to deny the truth in this to be able to go. You just have to deny it, because otherwise you can see that baby's picture. You can see that baby. Baby's living. And even if you say, well, that's baby's 5 months, 6 months, what about the early abortions where most of them are? It's true. I concede that. Most of the abortions are early on when you don't. Way back. But, you know, we have a beating heart at 21 days. We have the formation of fingerprints just a few weeks after that. We have brain waves at 5 weeks. And even before that, we know the genetic code. The genetic code says it's not going to be a turtle, it's not going to be a monkey, it's not going to be a banana. So people know this. So the idea that it's not a human being is fallacious, that people can't, you know, it's scientifically proven there. The bigger question is the second one, may I kill it? And it goes back to your first question about the word choice. And we use that word choice, it's a cover-up. It's a cover-up for the other things. But basically, we've established it as a human being. So now, if that's the case, how do we deal with that human being? How do we deal with that? And we see it's cheapening to die. Life, look at the slaughter that we have in places like a few months back, where Pakistan, there was right in Pakistan, 100 people killed in a school. Or what we see in so many of these all around the country, it's related to our cheapening of the value of human life. And how is that most demonstrated in numbers? Abortion. And so this is, you know, it's a problem which needs to be looked at in terms of really revering life. And the second part, just to review again, afterwards, when somebody's gone through that, not to despair, not to be despondent, not to write off God from the picture because they feel they can't come back to Him at all. Not at all. This is the time of God's mercy. This is the time when somebody who has failed can come back. It's never, never too late. And that is the thing that I enjoy doing most in working with the abortion issue and Priests for Life. And again, it's not just abortion. It's also about the end of life, you know, the cheapening of life there and the rest.
It's very common for men, often for many years, to have a sense that abortion experience, while perhaps unfortunate, didn't really impact them. They don't have any feelings about it, they think. What I find is when they're given an opportunity to step out of their lives and look at that event and talk about it and share about it, there's some really powerful emotions about their role in that abortion decision. Now, keep in mind, if a man was powerless to stop an abortion, he experiences the same level of trauma that many women experience from the procedure, because that's a unique aspect of a man's role. If he's unable to protect that child from death and he feels powerless, you're going to see deep depression. You're going to see rage and anger. You're going to see that manifest in his relationships, in addictive behaviors, and a host of problems. Very serious, and they need if possible, immediate intervention. For most men, though, their role in the abortion is, it varies. Sometimes it's pressuring the mother to abort, so they have that particular shame and guilt about their role. Other times there's an ambivalence and thinking they're being supportive by not doing anything. And they later realize that as a man, not doing anything to protect that child makes them very complicit. And again, there's a lot of shame and guilt and grief about that. So when they have that opportunity on the retreat to share, again, the emotions are very strong. You know, men may be able to hold those emotions at bay, repress them for many years, but they're in there. And they affect them. They affect their lives. Even if they aren't aware of them, they're impacting their lives.
There are two things about this. What this horrific thing of Roe v. Wade has created, two things. Number one, it's allowed the man to use her and then just discard her if the wrong thing happens. He wants her, I'm talking about free sex, and this is a bigger problem even, you know, beforehand. Pregnancy takes place, and he says, oh, he's surprised. I don't want a kid. Get the kid out of here. I don't want a kid. How many times do you hear this kind of thing? I'm not talking about guys who understand this, but I'm talking about a number of people who don't. Now we have a law that says, hey, no problem. Go down to the Planned Parenthood. We'll take care of it. Get the procedure. Get on with your life. You're okay. And the guy says, forces her so many times, pushes her into this. So that is an aspect of this. This is about women's rights, but, you know, it's about the guy who pushes her into having an abortion. Or it's about her telling him that I'm pregnant, but I'm going to have the abortion, and he doesn't want that because now he finds out he's a father. You see how unjust this is. In both cases, it's an injustice. And then you have the situation, too, that he's no right whatsoever to even contest that. She has absolute right over the domain of the child because the courts see this as property, and that's a big thing. We've got to get back to seeing that this is a person. That's why any personhood, initiatives, I think, are very, very important. We go back to the Civil War, and we understand about slavery today. And the slavery was about personhood versus property. And property won in the Dred Scott decision, but the Civil War changed that. And, of course, the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments in this country guaranteed the rights of all people. And so it's about people, it's about persons, it's not about property. But the law oftentimes sees her carrying it, because after all, she should have the abortion, and if the abortion goes wrong, it's her property. No, it's not her property. We don't own other human beings, and that's another concept we need to get back there, and that's theology of the body shows you that dramatically. Thing I think we begin with the thoughts we have, then the words we have, and then the actions. And so the thoughts we have to be relative to life. We have to realize the truth is on the side of life. The truth is defending life. So the words we use, to give an example, the word pro-choice. I don't use that word, and I recommend that nobody uses that word pro-choice. They've gotten away with it. Is it pro-life, pro-choice? Are those the polarities? No. Pro-life, pro-death, or pro-life, if you want to be specific, pro-abortion. What's wrong with calling it what it is? That's all we're saying. Just call it what it is. But they don't want to call it that, because if you say abortion, you get too close to saying, well, what is abortion? Abortion is the killing of that child. I don't want to touch that, because now we revealed the horror for what it is. Mm-hmm. So there's a cover-up here. And so that's what people should start with, the language. We, even pro-life people, use the word pro-choice. We shouldn't use that word, pro-abortion. And then somebody can say, don't call it pro-abortion, call it pro-choice. And then you have the opportunity, the stage, to say, what's wrong with calling it what it is? People want honesty. I mean, in general, they respect that. But choice is a hypocritical word when it's used in terms of abortion. And, of course, we could use other things, too. You know, are you expecting a child? Well, where is the child now that you're expecting? You have the child in your womb. It's just that the child is not yet revealed to the public. It's like Christmas. Christmas is not the beginning of Christ's time on earth. It was the Annunciation 9 months before. And that's a very important feast because that's when he became man. That's when things changed. Christmas is just the public display of that. Together, I mean, our late Holy Father, St. John Paul II, I mean, he put all these Wednesday afternoons, put together to show the importance of understanding we who have the human flesh. And this makes sense through the incarnation of Jesus Christ coming on earth. I mean, it makes the deepest sense. But the theology of the body, understanding the reverence for the body, that's where it starts. It actually starts with the family, you know, and we need to champion the family. We need to champion marriage, too. Because there's only one way that God has given us that, and that's, of course, the main purpose of that is to bring about and to perpetuate the human race and not to end it. And it's amazing how people talk about how they want to live their lives, gay people, you know, in the future, that there isn't a future if there aren't children. So we have to look at that, too. And in the abortion area, we have to look at it as well to recognize that, you know, life, human life, begins right at that first moment of conception. And we need to treasure the little things in life.
The most important first step is acknowledging that that there has been a loss and their role in that abortion decision. And you know, men, they want to stand up and say and speak the truth. And it's an interesting difference between men and women. When men and women give their testimony in Silent No More, oftentimes when men get up, one of the first things they say is they need to be accountable. They'll say, I wasn't a man. I didn't protect the life of my unborn child. And then they may share their story and their own particular grief and loss and pain, but they really need to stand up and be accountable as men. And I think that's because that's the nature of who we are as men. It's acknowledgement, and I think this is where men and women, and this is what's beautiful about the Rachel's Vineyard Retreat and men and women gathering and journeying through that healing process together, is of course there's acknowledging the loss, dealing with the very painful feelings and giving a voice and expression of those very painful feelings is very important. And then, of course, developing a spiritual relationship with the child. So, and of course, repentance is going to be part of that. Not only acknowledging the feelings, but also repenting to God and confessing that sin. If one is Catholic, of course, receiving the sacrament of confession within the context of that retreat weekend. That's very important because that brings grace to continue that healing work. And then as you deal with the painful feelings, you deal with your role, God's grace, the sacraments, and then you move into the area of realizing the hope that even though that child has died, there's the hope of a spiritual relationship with that child and entrusting that child to God's mercy with the hope that at some point we'll be reunited with the unborn child in heaven. And again, that's one that we entrust with mercy, and we have the hope of God's not only his justice, but his great mercy. And the retreat program and the exercises all facilitated an ability to connect in a very real way with that child, to grieve that child's loss, but to reconnect in love. Because so many of the symptoms of post-abortion grief for men and women is that relationship has been severed. It's the relationship with the child is very complicated, it's very dark, often there's nightmares about the child and things. And so to deal with those painful feelings and reconnect in love with that child, with all the grace and the beauty of the scriptures and the whole Paschal mystery, it's almost as you could think the Paschal mystery of their journey. You know, they've sinned, they've experienced the cross, they've experienced death and darkness and the work of Satan. It's impacted and touched them very intimately. But now God's grace comes and they experience the resurrection with Christ, and the hope of the resurrection, of course, is their spiritual relationship with their unborn child, that not all is lost in Christ. One of the reasons that the program was spread all over the world, hundreds of translations and countries, and hundreds of, I guess, almost nearly 1,000 retreats a year, I think, around the world, is it's spread because two reasons. One, it is a very effective emotional and spiritual healing process. The wound of abortion is very, very deep within the body, within the spirit. It touches on the intimate areas of sexuality, of spirituality, procreation, you know, so these are the deepest parts of the human person, and some very dark things that are in because of that loss and because of the role in that loss. So what the retreat is successful at doing is emotionally opening up the heart and the body and the mind to deal with those painful feelings, but then also flooding the heart and the mind with God's grace. And if people experience that, you often hear it's said by those who minister on these retreats and serve in the teams that the participants come in Friday and they're very anxious and afraid. You can see that burden, the years of pain in their faces. And then when they leave on Sunday, there's almost a transfiguration in a sense, you know, a brightness that you see in the change that occurs. That doesn't mean that the healing journey doesn't continue. Of course, you know, there's lots of seeds planted, but you have to kind of nurture those seeds of faith, and you have to, as Jesus said, go and sin no more. And, you know, you have to continue to do the work, emotional and spiritual work, but there's a really strong foundation that's established. So it's very effective, and it's spread because of that. But now we also have that element of evangelization. When someone's been touched that intimately by Christ and the church, it's such an area of shame and grief and guilt and loss that they want to share that good news. And so the biggest spreaders of Rachel's Vineyard, of the seeds of new vineyards, are those who have experienced God's mercy and healing. Abortion healing that's so essential for the health of our families and communities and societies, that a man who has participated in abortion, he may be a fine man, he may be doing his best to provide for his family, maybe a good person, but there's a woundedness that occurs in the heart and soul of a man who's participating in the death of one of his children. It weakens him as a man. He can't be all that he could be. There's elements of his vocation that are compromised because of that. So, in the healing process, again, because of God's mercy, there's a restoration. There's a strengthening of a man emotionally, physically, psychologically, spiritually as well. That makes him, and we've seen this in the healing of men, they become stronger, more loving fathers and husbands. They're better in the workplace because sometimes there's anger issues and other problems that are associated with not dealing with loss that could affect them and make them less effective in the workplace. Certainly the relationship, their emotional connection with their wives and children. Oftentimes the way people deal with complicated grief and loss that's not dealt with is you become workaholic, there's various addictions. Pornography is also an area where men can act out areas of grief and loss and complicated feelings. So if you can heal those kind of deep wounds like abortion, you strengthen men. We have stronger families, stronger marriages, we're going to have stronger communities. So, you know, abortion healing, I think, with over 50, 60 million abortions we're approaching now in our country alone, just think if we could begin to reach out to just a percentage of those men, how that would begin to transform our society.
I find myself here on my knees again, caught up in grace like an hour.